to be a fashion photographer. I like to choose someone who went through that and has become a well-known fashion photographer for a short period of time. I'm very pleasure on behalf of Digital Camera to introduce you to Lara Jade.
Hi everyone. Well, there's a lot of you here. I think this is my biggest talk yet, so not scary at all, right? I am so excited to be on the super stage and telling you, because one thing I'm passionate about is a journey of evolution in photography. And starting from a photographer from Tamworth, very close to Birmingham, I'm really excited to kind of come full circle and back here to finally give you a 10-year journey. So it's going to be almost 10 years to the day that I decided to sign up my business in photography. So I'm so excited that timing worked out. I have so much to tell you guys, the mistakes, things that I've done, things that you can learn from. And this seminar is not just for fashion photographers. This is for wedding, portrait, anyone that wants to take a fashion element or to learn publishing and those kind of, you know, things in the industry I've learned, I want to kind of go through those. So I started, I'm sure many of you will remember this, I started as a photographer on DeviantArt.com. And how many, raise your hands if you're all DeviantArt. Now, there's a fair few of you. So I went from, my friend said earlier, he went from Lara Fairy, which I thought was a great username, to Lara Jade. So my Lara Fairy days, so this was one of the first images I took. So I got into photography purely because I wanted to experiment. And I found photo manipulation online, and I was amazed at how creative you could be. So not having models, being a very shy teenager, I started to use myself in my pictures to understand and to hone my skills. So this was actually on holiday in Blackpool, and there was these beautiful red curtains. I sat in the window, I set the camera up, and I experimented. So sometimes when I look at these images and what I learned, what I think is, wow, like, I would love to go back and have no pressure. The pressure I have with certain clients now is like way up here, where this was like, okay, I think I'm gonna create a nice photo today. So when this kind of came about, so the early days, DeviantArt, I was around 14, 15. So these were my early experimentations. And what I found was, because I was using myself as a model, I was kind of working with wigs and different kind of, you know, outfits to kind of disguise myself in photographs. So I was building my portfolio as a self-portrait artist and also learning about lighting. So my first studio was my mom's bedroom. Thanks, Mom. So first studio was my mom's bedroom. It had beautiful natural light coming in the window. I'd have my models pose like this on the back of the bed, wide angle looking down. And then that was my starting point. So from there, and you know what the main thing is? I never let limited equipment and space get in my way. So I was always creative. My first camera was my dad's camcorder, which I used to steal, and he'd go crazy with where it had gone. So I would use my dad's camcorder. I would use, you know, very limited camera equipment and take photos. So I would then upload these images online to DeviantArt, to Flickr, and very thankful for MySpace back in the day, because what I found is when I was taking these images, that putting these images on those websites, I was able to build a community, I was able to get constructive criticism, and I was able to bring kind of a support network. You know, being a teenager in the West Midlands with not a ton of friends, I was kind of a recluse in my bedroom, being all arty, and at the time I was very like dark and gothic, and this was cool for me. So I was creating these images, but what I found was at some point, they had to evolve from there. So the evolution from me was when I started my business at the age of 17. So the reason I started my business is purely because I was getting a lot of interest from book cover clients such as HarperCollins and Random House in America, and was also getting interest from people on MySpace and other websites like Flickr, where they wanted this beautiful image of themselves in scenery. So very unglamorous, the ways we would do these. This was actually shot in Wales. So this was one of my clients that became my muse. And we would drag the suitcase of clothing into like the National Trust place and pretend we were just on a day out. And I don't know how we didn't get stopped for that, but we would drag these clothing into there and we would just create, and then we would hide when the people would come around, like security would come around. So again, not letting limitations kind of define me as a photographer. So So my creativity started to go really out there when I was doing images like this. So these particular images I shot with a creative team. So working with people who were my clients, who were also very creative, they wanted to be a part of my imagery. And then they would say, well, I know someone at a theater wardrobe that can bring these clothes in, and I know someone that has this birdcage in this hippie commune. Let's create something. So honestly, when I'm going through my whole thing, what I always want to point out is the team is absolutely crucial, the creative team, in creating beautiful images. So another example, so no excuses, guys. I know so many people say to me on workshops and photo shoots, oh, but I shoot like real people and I can't build my portfolio because they don't want to be creative. No excuses. These two girls here were people that came to me for the typical boudoir portrait photography. So they looked at this online, but for some reason thought I would do that. So I'd shoot what they wanted, but at the end of the day, I would say, I'd have this wardrobe of clothes that I would thrift from eBay or Amazon or even just charity shops. And I would say, at the end of the day, after our shot has finished, could we please do something that I could creative for my portfolio? So in this instance, it was about the flooded lake that was over the road from my mom's house when I was living with her. It was about the forestry in the woods and just turning her away from the camera. So all about the fine art aspect. At this point, I was not thinking about fashion photography. I was not thinking commercially. I just had a real sense of wanting to create. And that's what I think is missing in so many photographers' work. It's this desire, it's this desperation to get paid. And yes, we all want to be paid. But the thing is, when you're creating, you're excited about creating, you naturally attract that. And that will come to you. But when what happens is, when people are shooting for money, and one of my dear friends, Sue Bryce, always says, it's like you reek of desperation, and clients will know that. So it's very important that when I'm showing you these, you see that in this instance for me, I was just so excited to create. I did not care that I had £50 in my bank account, and I would spend that last minute of money on a train to get to Wales to shoot with my friends. I would do whatever it took to be creative. So at this point, I was uploading these images online, and I started to attract the attention of publishers like HarperCollins, Random House, and they would find my images purely through keywords on DeviantArt and Flickr. So there's a lot of art directors out there that saw my creativity, creative directors, producers, saw the creativity and could imagine it in a book cover. At the same time, I was also using my very close friends to build my portfolio. So this was me drowning my friend Prudence, who, by the way, loved to be in any shot. So I would have her out in the snow, I would have her out, this was a cold tank of water, because her dad had amphibians. So anything I could get my hands on, be creative with, and sometimes I even surprised myself. So at this point, Photoshop was crucial in taking that work to a different place, taking it to a fantasy element as well. So here's some examples of that. So on the right here, this book cover for Heather Dixon Entwine, this was for Random House. So they purchased that image from me. So at this point, I started to realize around the age of 17, 18, when starting my business, that great, my work's got interest in America. And also has commercial interest. So this is when I realized that there's value in my work and clients are interested. On the left here, the Madman's Daughter was actually a commissioned piece. So I was building the trust with those first clients by having them purchase work, but then at the same time building the trust so that they would commission me. So at this point, I was finding every month I was getting a commission to shoot a book cover. But what I found was, even though I enjoyed the process, I didn't just want to be a teen book cover photographer. And the reason was because I started to become more interested in styling. I was researching fashion photographers. I kind of figured out where it is that I wanted to go with my work, and then kind of took it from there. So this was the starting point of me realizing, as a photographer, I could use this in a commercial industry as well. So what did I do? So I packed my bags, I saved a little bit of money, and I ran to London, because everybody was telling me London is the place to be. Absolutely, London is the place to be, but I was not used to the industry. So what happened is I ran there, I was paying far too much rent very quickly. I was shooting these in my living room space of my studio. I had, at the time I had a sponsorship from Bowens, and they were helping me out with a little bit of kit, But again, I didn't know what I was doing with it. So what I found was, and you guys can probably see that jump, the jump from being a fine art photographer and being very creative to something totally out of my realm. And what happened here, and the evidence of this, is purely that I let the stylist and the styling team overrule me. So what was apparent was I am inspired by feminine, girly, creative, kind of, you know, pretty things. So I go to London, I'm like, great, it's all about the team, and I want to work with a stylist, and I work with hair and makeup, and then, you know, I come back in the room, and this is going on. And I'm like, well, I guess I have to push through this. And also, it's a good lesson. This was a big lesson for me. When I was shooting work like this, it was a huge lesson for me to understand that do not let the team overrule you. Your vision as a photographer is absolutely key, and your personality and your vision should be one and one. When you are meeting clients, they have to see your work in you. So I was shooting this work and I was getting feedback from editors. I'd also gone to New York for a few months to see a few friends, and I fell in love with the industry over there. So I kind of felt like I was spread apart. So New York style, like a bit edgier in London, and then this kind of pretty fine art. So I had three portfolios. One consisted of this, one consisted of fine artwork because I felt like I was still getting money from that, and one consisted of more editorial, kind of in the realm that I wanted to do. So I set aside a plan and I was listening to feedback, and I said, what are you doing? You got into photography to be a creative artist when your vision shines through. So what I did is I started to think of themes in fashion photography that linked through to the fine art themes and the beautiful kind of feminine themes and the light. So the consistency. So if you're thinking about my early work is mainly on location. It's natural light, it's backlit, it's soft. So I started to bring those initial elements back into my work, and I saw a huge change in the people that would book me as a photographer. So this was actually shot for Material Girl in Germany, so it's a magazine. So what I started to find is I brought those elements into the studio. So instead of shooting a model with harsh light, with beauty dishes, with three different lights, I pulled back. This was actually the modeling light on my Octobox. And what I did was just shot really wide open and changed the white balance and then desaturated it. So at this point, and you'll notice I'm not a very technical photographer. I know what I need to know for my style and I know what I need to know for certain clients, but I'll kind of think out the box and just really push my experimentation and see how it would go. And this experimentation period of shooting things like this and reaching out to small magazines, and yes, I would cold call. So I would reach out to these magazines and I would say, I would love to shoot for you. Here's evidence of my work. This is my vision as a photographer. I showed them everything I wanted to shoot for. So I always say to people, when I'm thinking about clients, always shoot for your target client in mind. If you want to shoot for British Vogue, you shoot with them in mind. Figure out what it is that the photo editor is attracted to with that work, what the editor is attracted to. With this kind of feel, I knew that Material Girl was very girly, it was very young, it was very soft. So when I pitched this idea, so essentially a pitch for those that don't know is me sending a mood board and shoot idea to a magazine and saying, I would love to shoot something like this for you. Maybe here's the team, here's the potential model, and them saying, here is a letter of recommendation so that the stylist can go out and take the clothes from the showrooms so you have brands, and then go out and shoot it. Within reason and control. So what I was starting to find, I was like, great, I finally have my voice as a photographer published. So the ladder of the editorial industry is initially having something that could potentially be seen in a magazine, shooting 8 to 10 pages of different outfits, keeping consistency with the light, hair, and then sending it off. This was another example, kind of figuring out what it was as a photographer I love to shoot. So I started to realize that I like shooting more than one girl. Groups, two girls together, color, soft light, brighter, pastels. So that when I showed clients this, for example, one of my biggest editorial jobs that I shot 4 or 5 years ago was with The Observer. So The Observer put me, when I met them, The Observer put me into their folder of pastel, soft, feminine, girly. So when they think of who would be the right photographer for that job, and I have met them with the evidence I can do that, they're gonna put me first for this kind of job. So as you see here, this is an example of shooting with more than one girl, two girls, three girls. Was evidence here enough for the client to see? So I have shot with that target client in mind. So from there, what I found was, again, experimenting, keeping that backlit, soft element, the feminine side. And for a while, I really fought this because I was like, oh, I want to be more edgy, I want to be cooler, I want to be London. But I was like, that's not me. I'm like that. So my work's going to reflect what I am. So I pushed and I started to think. So when I visited New York, I hadn't got my team anymore. So this was around the age of 20. Now, I've been living in New York for nearly six years now. And I always find there's a difference between the two markets, which I'll go into a bit later on. But what I found was when I was in New York, I had to re-find my team. I had to re-find my voice. I had to convince people to work with me because no one knew me. And it's also a really hard industry because there's more photographers in the US that venture there than they do in London. Not to say London's not hard, but I found that when I was there, I found that I was kind of went back a few steps. But taking that reflection on my work made me realize and made me want to work harder as a photographer. So I pushed, I experimented, I pitched ideas. I would send 200 emails a week to different magazines. I would make lists. I still do. Every Monday, Marketing Monday I call it, I send 200 emails a week. Because if you don't put yourself out there, nobody is going to know that you exist. So I was sending emails to people like Velvet Dubai and saying, this is my work. I would love to work for you. I've got this stylist that I've met that I would like to bring her along. And then they said, great, we have a Dolce & Gabbana feature. We would love for you to shoot. I said, my dream client, absolutely. I would love to shoot this for you. So what was important here is I started to realize the value in better models and better teams. So at this point, I'm climbing the ladder to the next step. Climbing the ladder to the next step of, I've got the evidence of doing smaller editorials, paper cut magazine, The Observer, like more of a mid-range kind of thing. And then I'm reaching out to various different clients internationally. And why I'm doing that is because fashion photography is an international business and it raises the PR around my work online and the clients that look at this. So this was in Dubai. So I know there is a ton of clients in Dubai that could see this on a newsstand or see that on a coffee table and then look at the work and look at the name of the photographer. So in this instance, I was trying to figure out reaching out to Australian magazines, reaching out to London magazines, and kind of working through that. So I've put this one in here because I actually shoot a lot from my apartment in New York. Now, many of you are like, oh, so you don't use a studio? How does that work? So I live in a live work space in New York. I've been there for 4 years. When I first moved in, I was so thankful for space because apartments there are like shoeboxes. So for me, it was about creating. I had a stylist that I met that lived down my hall, and I started to experiment. I started to work with better models. Now on location, I tend to use just natural light, scrims, and reflectors because I run off with the model. So everyone gets mad at me because I grab the model and I'm like, I don't want to deal with them, let's just run off and create something, because otherwise you've got primping, everyone's jumping in your shot. So for this shot, I was like, great, my whole idea of the day is ruined. You know, the team are all like, what do you mean we have to come back here later? This is a hard shot. So I said, trust me. So we shot the whole editorial through where I wanted to do. And then at the end of the day, when the light was perfect and coming from behind the buildings, we went back. So shooting this shot has actually got me so many advertising options with very big clients because I have the evidence that I can shoot location editorials in hard places. So what I find is when I send images like this to potential clients or show them, for some reason they pigeonhole me as the girl that can take 20 shots in Times Square or the girl that can work in the heat in the summer of New York on the Brooklyn Bridge. Now, shooting in New York is not easy, but I've also shot myself in the foot by showing the evidence of doing that. So I sent some images recently to, it was last year, to Material Girl, which is Madonna's clothing brand. And they said to me, we would love for you to do a shoot in Times Square. I said, great, fantastic, how many shots? 20. So you know what Times Square is like. You're working around different kind of, you know, it's hot in the summer, you're working around people. So then as a photographer, again, you have to think, how do I make this work? How do I make this shot work when there's people walking in the background? I do not have, I had a permit to be able to be around and shoot in without a tripod, kind of an optional permit, but I did not have a permit to shoot off the Brooklyn Bridge. So it's about working with what you have. In Times Square, I shoot on a wide aperture, I shoot on telephoto lens, I shoot on my 85, I follow the model, I focus, I take about 2,000 shots in a day, and one or two of each look is exactly on point. So that's how I work it. So a lot of my clients book me for that exact reason. So another thing with editorial photography is consistency. And I review a lot of portfolios, I see a lot of work online on my groups, I get a lot of emails, and I find that one thing that is missing with work is consistency. Now, when locations are changing and your girl is present in the story and hair and makeup is slightly changing and the makeup, the clothing is changing in each shot because of the credit, how do you keep that consistency? So for me, that consistency is seen through the toning of the images. Color treatment is extremely important. It's seen through the feel of the images. So for this shoot, it was very important that where I was shooting in New York had that old-fashioned vibe. It was extremely important that that kind of old brick, the way she was walking down the street there, it could be taken back in time. The Brooklyn Bridge, everything has that feel to it, and the same thing with light as well. So this is one of my clients, Harrods, who I work with quite regularly, a very good client of mine. And I work with them, and for them, I am their photographer that shoots girly, feminine work. So if they want an actress to be shot for an interview and she's in a gown, they choose me if I'm in town. And the same with this. This was a Dolce & Gabbana interview with the two designers, and they said to me, we would love for you to shoot this. So this was a matter of, okay, this is an excellent opportunity because now I'm starting to be booked as a photographer for what I want. And I found that these are from the last 2 years. So when I'm being booked for jobs, finally, after all those years of figuring those things out, making sure that my, you know, my editorial is consistent, the light, the way I pose the model, the casting of the girl, everything has a voice and people remember me for it. This was actually shot in Costa Rica for Hello Fashion. So when we shot this, I found that this was an awful day. Now, every person that deals with me on set thinks I'm a nightmare. My friend Deborah, who I love, she always says to me, you're like a cat trying to find a litter box. Because I'm trying to get my shot and the light's not working and I can't figure out where I'm shooting and this is going on and there's too much wind on the beach and then my assistants, I'm too distracted about them getting their ankles wet in the sea that I'm like this. And she's like, have you found your litter box yet? Where is your shot? And I'm like, I haven't found it yet. But I love that kind of humor on set. So this was an example of, we went to this ranch, it was crazy. There were these parrots talking to each other in Spanish. It was just weird, weird everywhere. And all there was this porch. We had midday sun all day at this porch. And I said to myself, how the hell am I gonna get this story? Like I said to my friend who was also assisting, I was like, I feel like this one's gonna be bad, like from the get-go. And I just had food poisoning a few months before, and we had the woman that owned the ranch cooking food in this like, oh, and I was just like, this is gonna be a disaster day, so what are we gonna do? So you think on your feet. So I was like, our opening spread could be the girl on the porch. We'll then wait, we'll shoot all the easy shots at the start of the day. We'll shoot the crop from here to here shots because it doesn't matter where we are, we just need a sense of the background. And then at the end of the day, when golden hour is around, we'll shoot with golden hour for the movement shots for the full length. So it's important to always get that shoot credit. Another example of, I'm very calm on the surface, but underneath I'm like, okay, what's going on? So this was an example of, I didn't scout the location. I got there, I didn't realize the sun was going behind the mountain. So this was in Woodstock in New York. So it's got this mountain kind of river. So I saw this shot the moment I got there. I ran out because I knew I wanted to use the river. And me being stupid and it worked out, is I thought, let's do that shot at the end of the day. So we get to the shot, I'm standing in rocks, I'm not in heels, I'm on my little, I'm with bare feet, trying to balance myself on this rock. and I'm trying to shoot these girls, and you know what, it was a matter of just getting the shot within 10 minutes because the light was about to go, and then relying on the color treatment to work. So in the car on the way home, I did the color treatment and did the mood board to show the team that this shoot has come together with consistency as well. So this was one of my last shoots I did in October in the Hamptons, and again, every story I have for a location shoot is exactly what you think. It's not glamorous, the model's cold, you're eating pizza for dinner. If you, like me, you don't love pizza when you're trying to work all day. So you've got pizza for dinner, you're working with low editorial budgets, you've been up since 4 a.m, you've hauled equipment there with your assistants are tired, the model's done. So this was a matter of keeping that energy on set. So again, waiting for the right light. So in this shot on the left, this was a matter of, okay, the original hair is blown into her face and she looks a mess. How are we gonna make it work? So I converse with my styling team at every point of the shoot. I want them there with me. I want them to see the back of my camera on location if I'm not tethering. I want them to, you know, I want it to be their piece and something they are proud of as well. So for this, it was a matter of, okay, let's rework this. Let's figure out a new plan for the hair, a new plan for the light. Let's figure out where we're gonna shoot on the beach and what kind of thing we're gonna have. So investment and experimentation. Don't think too heavily about the payment aspect. I know everybody's put off by fashion photography because they feel they're gonna be broke. Supplement your income, work with it on another thing, because it's always about creativity first, build your portfolio, understand, you know, learn taste as well, understand what it is that you're attracted to personally. So personal taste defines what you shoot. So first of all, educate yourself on what you like. So what is it you are attracted to as a human being? So for me, I like girly things, I'm feminine, that's what I'm personally attracted to. I want to shoot women in that way. So it's important that my voice as a photographer comes across that way. Infuse your work with your personality, and also tell me your three goal clients. You know, the one thing I always say to my workshop students is I'll point at them. I'm quite cruel with that. I point at them at some point in the day and I'll say, top three clients, and they'll go, like that. And everybody does it. I've done it. I went to a meeting recently with a really big client.